What's up, world? Welcome to a very special edition here at Black Power Media and a collaboration with our Blacklash, the Africana Collective. And in just a moment, we're, of course, going to have an extension of a previous conversation that we started as a collective earlier this year around gender and womanhood. And we're going to extend that conversation a little bit today through a look at Black masculinity and manhood with Dr. Tommy Curry in just a minute. My colleagues from the Blacklash Collective, Drs. Mjiba Freyawat and Kwasi Konadu, are on their way. It's a clerical error that is entirely my fault that has them delayed. Dr. Curry is here and waiting patiently and will join us in just a second. But in that few minutes of interim, as we gather and encourage people to join us for this conversation, please do jump in the chat and make your comments and questions known with respect and comradeship, of course, as is often and always the case, if not always the case, here at BPM. Please do stay tuned and come back tomorrow morning and join me and us, Brother Kaba, on I Mix What I Like Live tomorrow at 8 a.m. Eastern. And then please come back throughout the weekend for Warrior Class, Sundays, I Mix What I Like Again on Monday, the Remix Morning Show again throughout the week, and so much more. So as I see my co-host has joined us, and let me again apologize to him and to all of you publicly and quickly introduce the fact that along with myself, my co-host for this evening, Dr. Kwasi Konadu, Dr. Mjiba Freyawat, Dr. Iyeli Ichile, and Dr. Todd Stephen Burroughs, we are the Blacklash Africana Collective that seeks to engage in interdisciplinary research to provide analysis and recommendations on a range of issues affecting the Africana world, linked communities with peoples of African ancestry. Using our collective knowledge and skills, as well as our grounding as thinkers, educators, activists, organizers, and parents, our objective is to support and inform action towards human flourishing and its safeguards in our worldwide communities. We are independent in our funding, research, and directives, allowing us to work decidedly in the best interests of said communities. I welcome Dr. Kwasi Konadu here initially first, professor of Africana Studies at Colgate University, author and head of Diasporic Africa Press, among many other things. Welcome, Dr. Konadu. Good to see you.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
All right. Okay. So we are again, as promised, joined in here this evening by Professor Tommy Curry, who, among many other things, is personal chair of Africana Philosophy and Black Male Studies, a multi-award-winning author and editor of Black Male Studies series at Temple University Press, and of course, author of The Man Not, The Man Not, and is, of course, joining us here again at Black Power Media. Brother Dr. Curry, it's a pleasure. Welcome to the program. Good to see you again.
Hey, brother. Thank you for having me.
So what we intend to do, if I have it correct, I'm not mistaken, if all are still okay with that, is to spend about the first hour in discussion with you and us, and then after that, open it up for questions from the community in the chat, and then go from there, and we'll wrap at roughly 8 o'clock Eastern time. And call it an evening. I would just like to start with the broad, as I often do, if it's okay, just the sort of broad, and of course, apologies, the full title is The Man Not, Race, Class, Genre, and the Dilemmas of Black Manhood, Temple University Press, 2017 is the exact publication date, at least on my Kindle copy here. And I just wanted to invite you to, if you could, give your sort of elevator summary of the argument. And then we have a whole bunch of questions. Dr. Konadu has a whole bunch of fascinating questions that I can't wait for us to check out as well. But if we could just start there, it's just so everybody's clear, those of us who have read the work,
sure. Who
may not, you know, what is the overall argument?
Yeah, well, you know, I think it's been 4 years since we first started talking about, you know, The Man Not and Black Belt Studies. So, you know, the scholarship around the field and the general sorts of questions has certainly exploded. But the initial argument poised in the book was really twofold. One was when we study Black men in the American university system or within disciplines, most of what we talk about is mythological. Very little of it has anything to do with science or empiricism. Even the very ways that we talk about Black men, and this is a more recent conversation, the categories of maleness that we find in intersectionality can be traced to anything actually scientific. The citations that you give for someone like a Kimberly Crenshaw, for instance, are direct quotes of white feminists, second wave white feminists, the authors of The Second Assault specifically, that are talking about Black men having compensatory masculinity, which is something they say in their book has never been proven that there's actually no evidence for. Despite that fact, the book was published in 1975, that's become a philosophical and almost intuitive notion of how we read Black men in the United States. So The Man Not was an attempt to situate Black manhood or maleness within more empirical and experiential categories of analysis. What happens if we look at Black manhood, how it developed historically? How do you explain the fact that Black men were thought to be feminine, savage, pedophiles, homosexuals, all in the same, you know, breath of 10 years. You know, in the 1970s, Joseph Plec suggested that because Black men weren't really men, they had a tendency towards homosexuality. He assumed simultaneously that they were feminine. Now, none of these are problems in and of themselves, but it raises the question, well, then how do they fit within this kind of historical notion of patriarchy? And The Man Not was trying to interrogate that. And when you look at Black maleness, it's a category of fungibility, it's a category of malleability, and often contradiction. So how is it that for the whole of human history, from enslavement forward and colonialism forward, you have Black men being defined as savage, apatriarchal men, but suddenly there's a turn in theory in the 1980s where they become patriarchs? Right before that moment, as I document in The Man Not, Black men were thought to be hypermasculine. And it's very fascinating. There's actually a literature review written by Plass, where they look at how hypermasculinity has been used and categorized in academic literature. And they find that it's a term that's largely been applied to Black and brown men. And I believe I said this before, when you actually look at the history of the term actually describes a female personality disorder. It's very much linked to what we think of as Monahan type ideology, because the notion was that since Black men didn't have fathers in the homes, they imitated their mothers. Because they imitated their mothers, they took on feminine characteristics. They inevitably sought to reject it. This increased deviance and misogyny towards women, because the idea was that trying to live out female ideas, beliefs, and gender performances created a tension, right? This is what people like Plec and even Monahan are drawing from when they're writing the reports in the 1960s. So Black male studies says, well, look, if we start looking at Black men in outside of what we intuitively associate maleness or patriarchy with, then what picture do we get? And when we start looking at those documents, we find fascinating debates that white women in the 1940s, for instance, were looking at Black men to define the very notion of the feminine. That the reason you have woman as a minority category is because white women looked at Jewish men and Negro men under segregation and then Holocaust and said, that's what feminine oppression looks like. Verbatim, the notion of masculinity that we have with patriarchy today was based on white women observing how white men treated the Negro. So then you ask yourself, well, if this is how white women formulated their notion of patriarchy and oppression, then how do Black men become synonymous when they were the victims that they used to get the very idea in the first place? What does it mean when we think about Black men being vulnerable? We traditionally think of maleness as being associated with death, murder, right? This is what we think of in gendercide and all kinds of forms, even genocide literature. We think men are killed and that's just the normal process of domination. But what happens when we look at sexual vulnerability? What happens when we look at child sexual abuse, the rates of intimate partner violence that affects Black men, the notion that the sheer numbers and prevalence of rape over the last decade? We find that Black men are equal to and surpass many female groups. So it means that the way that we think about maleness has to shift, right? That what we think of as the category of maleness doesn't fully encapsulate what's actually happening to Black men and other racialized males in the United States and across the world. So Black male studies developed as a field to study those contradictions, to give some empirical grounding to the types of sociological and epidemiological phenomena that we see throughout disciplines to this very day.
Mm-hmm. All right. Brother Konadu, you wanna jump in?
Sure.
How you doing, brother?
Greetings, how you doing, man?
I'm doing well.
Wonderful. Pleasure to have you on and be on this show. So a slight bit of a background to the title for this conversation, Malcolm and manhood, Black manhood. I think we all know that for many in his own time and thereafter, Malcolm stood as a prism, if you will, of the kind of discipline, the kind of fatherhood, the husbandhood, sort of a multidimensional frame in which we can think about, if not a kind, but a prototype of a kind of Black manhood for many. We can think of Ozzie Davis's eulogy.
That was coming to mind. Right. Yes.
You know,
so is our manhood, yes.
Indeed. So that was sort of the ethos, sort of inspiration for thinking about, you know, this chat we wanted to have. And I want to make this very clear that having read The Man Not, fully, that developed a few questions for the purpose of conversation. Some of the questions I will be asking is I'm trying to think about what other people who have not read it yet and have already made up their minds about The Man Not, but they haven't read it. And for all of us, right, for all of us who are in the academy, we know what that looks like. So there's a series of questions here that I have, but they're intermixed with a number of what we think other folks may have about. So the first question is, you know, to build on what you said, because the scholarship certainly has grown since the publication of your piece. So what is The Man Not, in quotation, sort of air quotes, as a theoretical formulation? And how does it really, as you say, capture the reality of Black maleness in an anti-Black world?
Wow, that's a great question. When I initially thought about The Man Not, I was reading basically 200 years of ethnology. And everything said, the Negro man is not a man. The Negro is not a man, right? All the way from 1854, well into the 1970s. So I start thinking about that seriously. What does this negation mean, right? In the 1970s, and this is the fascinating part about it. In the 1970s, there was an explosion of feminist theory, largely white women, who admitted that Black men were not men and that we're not patriarchs, right? So you could look at the Holmes and Williams book, The Second Assault. You can look at Firestone's book, The Dialectics of Sex, right? Everybody's like, Black men are not men, Black men are not patriarchs. But there was this moment where they start reading psychoanalysis and they said, well, Black men are not men, but they perform like the child next to white men. So using Freudian logic, right, or the Oedipal complex or ego development, whichever you prefer, they suggested that the Black man aspires to be the white man. And this became a paradigm, right? This is basically, right, you know, this is Wallace, this is bell hooks, right? Black men aspire to be like white men. And I said, well, listen, why do we have to go there? Because that we already know that's false, right? The women themselves who wrote this said that this was false, but this is their theoretical orientation, reading Freud. What does it mean for us to seriously contemplate the negation of manhood? We've been taught that intuitively we situate the negation of manhood as a reactionary frame that Black men took upon themselves to gain manhood, right? And we've done that through what I take to be, as I show in the introduction to my book, right, very sloppy readings of things that Stokely Carmichael has said, or, you know, half quotes from Sojourner Truth, et cetera. So if we think about it as a negation, I became interested in this question that I kind of deal with at the end of my book, dealing with Newton and some of the more pessimistic frames of Black eschatology. Well, then what have Black men made of manhood through negation, right? How have we expanded the present or the now? How have we embraced fatherhood? How have we expanded, in King's words, agape, even though he knows that he won't be there? What are the ways that Black men have existentially rewritten or recodified maleness that has not been seen in the academy? So the man knot is the placeholder for what I call a genre or a kind of oppression in being that escapes actual thought and categorization. Mm-hmm. And I find it to be appropriate because, you know, I know some of the debates in the academy have such a hostility towards anything that studies men and males, mm-hmm. that Black male studies become synonymous with whatever they picture maleness as. And I think that that really does speak to the point. Because if you have a history, right, and I'll give you a really brief example of this. When I talk about Jewish men being raped in the Holocaust, I use the man not category because it's a category of fluidity, something that's filled in by the negation of racist caricature and oppression. Jewish historians completely understand it because there's not an antagonism to understanding the suffering of Jewish men within the Holocaust. There's no pushback whatsoever. There's actual encouragement to study Jewish men being raped within the camp. When I make the exact same argument, I mean verbatim, considering our own people, mm-hmm. there's antagonism, mm-hmm. as if somehow we shouldn't study the fact that Black men have experienced rape, sexual assault, child sexual assault throughout history, not only including slavery and Jim Crow, but even today. So then we ask ourselves, well, then why the difference? It's the same argument. It's the same kind of evidence. Mm-hmm. And it's because there's something about Black maleness that's so antagonistic that even theoretically, it's the launch pad of how other kinds of theoretical accounts become free. Mm-hmm. And I mean that very seriously, because we locate Black maleness as an antagonism to womanhood, as an antagonism to queerness, as an antagonism to transness, it is theoretically situated intuitively as a category of condemnation. And what I wanted notness to do was be the placeholder to interrogate that kind of condemnation. Because I can give you data sets all day to show that most of the things we think is theoretically associated with Black men is not true. But that doesn't change the effectivity of how people relate to maleness. I can show you data sets all day about, you know, Black men being killed by, you know, their wives and girlfriends or, you know, same-sex coupling. But that doesn't register. So we need some kind of apparatus that allows us to interrogate Black manhood, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And see pluralities in Black manhood that can't simply be talked about as masculinity or masculinities.
Mm-hmm. Brother Jared, you want to jump in or can I follow up?
No, please keep going. Okay, cool. I don't want to mess up the flow.
No, it really is because what you're laying out for us does raise a sort of follow-up question, which is, mm-hmm. You know, as you write, the Black man experiences the world as a man not, right? Mm-hmm. But the question is, but whose world, in terms of this anti-Black world, whose world, mm-hmm. or which world, you know, are we talking about here? In other words, is it a U.S. geographical space? Is it so-called Atlantic mm-hmm. space? It is an African world space?
It's a great question.
Right, so whose world?
Yeah.
And by that I mean, I didn't see much in your work, and this depends upon the first question, of course, about, for example, Black men in Africa, mm-hmm. because you do reference a colleague and friend of mine's, Oyewumi's work, excellent work at Yoruba Society, right? Mm-hmm. So the question about whose world came to mind as you're framing this man not?
No, that's a great question, brother. You know, and I appreciate the actual engagement. I enjoy actually talking about the text. At the time that I wrote the book, it was U.S.-centered. Mm-hmm. And the reason for that was because as I say in the book, I thought of this as a case study that leads to a larger accumulation of theoretical backing. Mm-hmm. So I didn't want to pull I dislike philosophy because I can make up something and then I just interpret everything along what I made up. Mm-hmm. And what I wanted to do was do a case study that showed that there's a basis of theoretical interpretation that I argue that I could get more and more evidence for, mm-hmm. right? So the first book was a case study of Black Americans, Black men in the United States, some references, of course, to some of the evidence in Canada through the studies, but mostly a North American context, right? Since that period of time, there's been scholars in South Africa and Africa that have expanded the concept to talk about Namibia and South African men mm-hmm. and how they suffer from certain forms of gender oppression. And that's exactly what I wanted to do, right? My second project is going to look at a theory of patriarchy that's going to talk more diasporically. Mm-hmm. But I wanted it to be a lens and to provide some grounding or theoretical principles that I think Black men throughout the Black world could actually use to interpret their view. If I can give a small example, when R.W.S. Connell came out with the idea of hegemonic masculinity, she was only studying Australian boys, schoolboys, right? In fact, most of the stuff that she writes about marginalized masculinity, which is how she reads racialized men, comes from Robert Staples' work, and she's extremely clear about that. Despite the fact that Staples basically created the first grounding of global South masculinities to interpret all racialized men, you know, outside the Western metropole, he receives very little credit for that. What I wanted to do was create, of course, you know, I give lots of credit to Staples and you know, other Black men like Anthony Lamell who've done this kind of work. I wanted to create a theory that we could actually use to interpret Black men throughout the global South and other racialized men. And what I wanted to do is say, well, look, here's the most non-biased way I can do that. Here's a set of principles and interpretive lenses that I argue are historically true, given the evidence we have before us. I think this will translate to any kind of Western patriarchal society. Jim Sedanius, who just recently passed, made a very similar argument about arbitrary sex discrimination, but I introduced sexual vulnerability. So I'm willing to put my cards on the table. Anytime you look at Black men in a racist society, you'll see two simultaneous caricatures, the idea of the rapist and the sexual vulnerability to rape. And people have been using this to test out what's been going on in their societies, and they find them simultaneously. So my hope is that while I did a case study that brought throughout theoretical principles from a certain historical reading of ethnology and sociology that studied the American context, that this is something that can be applied and is being applied diasporically, because we're building up a case study of evidence showing the propensity for my theory to actually be predictive rather than simply descriptive.
Mm-hmm. Right on. Yeah, right on. I like that.
Again, I like facts, Joe.
Hey, Jared, can I keep going? Or
man, please keep going, man. I've had the pleasure of having sort of these conversations with Brother Curry before, so I'd like to keep hearing what you've got to say. There is also a nice overlap in the questions that you have with some of my own. And then I'll just park the rest of mine for whenever. So, you know, so please continue. We can get to mine when we get to it.
I'm enjoying the conversation, though, so please.
Yeah, me too. Please. Me too.
Sure thing. Some years ago, I taught a class that was on the books. I hadn't created it, called Black Men in Your Society. And there was a few texts that I'd used for that class because this was actually probably 2006. 2007. Mm-hmm. And as you know better than I do, because my focus is more African, African diaspora mm-hmm. history, that it was tough finding literature.
Absolutely.
It was tough. And so there's a question here where, you know, while I agree with much of your critique of US academic disciplines and the theories and the mm-hmm. theorists, you know, that you target, including Crenshaw, you know, Michelle Wallace and a few others that I think are right for that, City of Hartman. Mm-hmm. I wonder why you didn't engage the works, for example, of Marcellus Blunt and George Cunningham, I think called Representing Black Men, that came out probably mm-hmm. in the 90s, like mid 90s. Mm-hmm. I think they try to engage in a theoretical enterprise as well. To what extent we can debate that, but I recall that they did. And less theoretical, but more on the theme of history. I think there was a mm-hmm. reader by Darlene Claude Kynes, the historian.
Yes.
Right.
Yes, the two or three volume one. Yeah,
you're right. Two volumes. Mm-hmm. And I'd mm-hmm. use excerpts from it in the class because I thought excerpts were more important than the actual introduction, which kind of lays mm-hmm. out her framework. So mm-hmm. I was wondering why those weren't part of your targeting, particularly the Blunt one.
Yeah, well, I mean, a few things. I think that when I wrote The Mad Nun, I was responding to a certain moment that happened about 4 or 5 years ago, where Black men were being, I think that's the beginning of Black men were trash kind of starting. Mm-hmm. And there was this notion of intersectionality being utilized in such a way that Black male privilege became practically synonymous anytime you said Black men. So I think that when I wrote the book, my focus was more on figuring out how we had this language emerging mm-hmm. at a time where we simultaneously were dealing with the very public executions of Black men. Mm-hmm. So I've read Blunt, I've read Hines, but they didn't seem to be appropriate targets, at least when I was writing the book at that time. I think now that I'm going back, like the second book, I'm actually working on the sequel to The Mad Nun. Mm-hmm. The second book is historiographic. Okay. So I certainly think that, you know, Hines is going to come out. Mm-hmm. But I rather like the introduction to the historical volumes, because one of the things I think Hines was trying to deal with the idea of kind of a plural masculinities mm-hmm. that change based on class and region and culture and context. So I appreciate that move, but I think that there's a lack of explanatory power in many of the readings that we have of Black men, right? Like you get the historical, you get the anthropological, but you don't get, well, what's driving this kind of elimination and ostracization of Black men, this demonization really, right? Because if you, you know, if you think about it, kind of going back earlier to the comment I made, you know, Black men have embodied practically every negative societal stigma throughout the 19th and 20th century. Mm-hmm. And I mean that in the sense that if you think of a category, if you think of an oppressed group, mm-hmm. right, Black men have been called that or interpreted as that way first. Mm-hmm. So before feminism becomes feminism in the 20th century, Black men are thought to be feminine. They're feminine men, right? Before homosexuality becomes, you know, demonized in the 60s and 70s, you get the rise of men's studies, Black men were thought to be homosexuals. Before that, they were thought to be pedophiles. Like every negative social category, Black men have embodied in some way, shape, or form, either scientifically or psychologically, right? So, yeah, I just really think that was an issue of focus, and I wanted to make sure. I knew when I wrote the book, people were going to have all kinds of negative things to say because I wrote a book about Black men. It wasn't just a book like, oh, Black men are bad. It's like, no, you really messed up how you interpret this. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to make sure I think that I got the primary sources of intersectionality of Black masculinity studies and then the data correct. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you're right. Like, I think one of the limitations is I didn't go back or I did. I mean, I read them, but I didn't include, you know, the kinds of debates I could have had with Hines' interpretation of Black men. I didn't include Blunt. I didn't include some of the brothers in Africa mm-hmm. that are writing about African masculinities and things of that sort, mm-hmm. which I'm actually very critical of because they're just importing Connell and calling it a day.
Right.
you know, and I reject that move wholeheartedly mm-hmm. because Connell, you know, and I've actually had this conversation more since I've been in the UK because I've asked very serious questions about why is it that Black men are hegemonic when by definition they're either subordinate or marginalized? Mm. Like people don't read Connell's work. So everybody's a hegemonic male, and that's not what Connell says. Capitalists and people that rule by ideology, tax policy, property, and you know, and radio, you know, are hegemonic. Everybody else that's working class, like working class white men are subordinate, and Black men are marginalized. Mm. There's a taxonomy here that never gets engaged, and we keep getting these very superficial readings. So there's just so much to undo, so to speak, right? I focused on the theoretical and the historiographic reorienting of conversations about patriarchy rather than some of the other sources that you just mentioned.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I'm definitely glad you mentioned data because that was another question that came up for me.
Okay.
And by all means, I don't want to subject you to what historians do because, you know, we do something different with data and that we can't do surveys. You know, we're basically at the mercy of what people leave behind, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I understand that.
You know, so yeah. The question is, you know, you do make it clear that, you know, your conclusions are drawn from actual data, right? Not mythology, mm-hmm. not fantasy. But on the other hand, there isn't any evidence that you collected your own data, meaning mm-hmm. all the Black men that you were in contact with. I would have loved to seen interviews, questionnaire, survey mm-hmm. to say, hey, you know, this body of knowledge, you know, adds to the theoretical frame that you're laying out. So, you know, you do rely on, therefore, government statistics and scholarly interpretation mm-hmm. of this and other data points. But as you and I know, and all of us know, as folks who are in the academy in some way, that stats lie and tell the truth at the same time.
Sure.
So the question is, why didn't you interview or survey all the Black men that you were in contact with, mm-hmm. Whose voices I think you want to represent?
That's a great question. For the first book, I thought of it, again, historiographic and theoretically, mm-hmm. right? So I didn't see survey or cross-sectional data as really applying to what I was interested in. In the last 4 years, we have done those projects, specifically around the issues of child sexual abuse, early sexual abuse, and some of the other work that we're looking at right now is looking at Black men's perception of their own male identity. So I think the qualitative aspect and the survey, the experiential aspect, is something that's kind of come after, you know, the man that was out there and we were trying to correct the theoretical frame. Mm-hmm. I find it most useful specifically to contextualize some of the larger data sets that I do use in the book. Mm-hmm. So one of the, I'll lay my cards on the table here. You know, my fascination with understanding quantitative data is what led me to get my master's of public health. So I'm actually, you know, literally I got 2 days to turn in my dissertation. I did a systematic review of intimate partner violence and homicide for Black men in the United States as the reference group for my dissertation. And this is the first, and this is the interesting thing. This is the first time in history anybody's ever read or written anything with Black men as the reference group of victims in intimate partner violence and homicide. So, you know, basically I surveyed, you know, since 1975 forward. And as much as I think qualitative data and surveys are important, I think it's important for us to also be able to intervene in the way that large data sets are being interpreted, right? You know, one of the weaknesses that we have is that we don't have a lot of Black epidemiologists that are making contributions to how we understand big data. And given the problem of undersampling Black people, the fact that we're constantly using weighted statistics and percentages to compensate for how many Black people we don't have in these data sets means that we're not getting a very complete picture of the kinds of dynamics that are happening in our communities. So that being said, is that I relied on large data sets and I didn't take them at face value. Mm-hmm. I actually said, look, you know, I want to make sure I get another degree, so I'm actually interpreting them correctly. Mm-hmm. And I think there are two things here. Like, you're absolutely right. Like, the lies the data tell usually surround how we try to interpret causal relationships. Mm-hmm. So I mentioned this to Jared before in our conversations about the way we interpret intimate partner violence and domestic violence numbers in like wind squares and even the CDC and ISVS data. You know, part of the problem is that we see disparity between, say, Black women, right? Because that's kind of our favorite reference group to talk about. We see large disparities of 12-month to lifetime prevalence of Black women in, say, general categories of intimate partner violence. But because of our intuition and interpretive mechanisms, we assume that intimate partner violence is caused by, say, toxic masculinity or patriarchy. Right. Mm-hmm. Which is a really dangerous idea. And I'll explain that in a minute. But we assume that. So then we assume that there's a causal relationship between Black men and their identity and the kind of violence they perpetuate or perpetrate in their homes and their communities. Well, when you look at the data set, though, there's another section that shows Black men's victimizations in these very same communities, in these very same age groups. Right. Mm-hmm. And you have extremely high rates of disproportionate violence against them, not only in heterosexual relationships, but also same-sex relationships, right? Then you look at child physical and sexual abuse. You have high rates of that, right? Mm-hmm. So when you're able to look at all these data sets and you say, okay, well, then what's going on here, right? And I control for something like class under 25,000. You know, I put it in R. I was like, okay, how is this breaking up? Well, then, you know, I find that this is poverty, right? I find this is neighborhoods. I find lots of data and scholarship looking at social determinants or socio-demographic factors that explain these disparities. So the issue there is twofold. One, I rely on big data because it shows us certain kinds of trends that I can't capture in surveys that, you know, that we've been doing thus far. But the other part too is that it also shows that we need a theoretical intervention in how we're interpreting this as scholars and theorists. Right. Because we're not having conversations with people in public health and epidemiology to actually discuss patterns of violence that are repeating or even incidences, right, of violence that are repeating in our communities. And what I wanted to do was create a theoretical apparatus, right, which was internalized vulnerabilities, right, as I introduced in chapter 3, that can explain why we see reoccurring patterns of violence. So one of the things that I found in the systematic review, and this actually surprised me because I didn't read it before then, but it really does give the man not some teeth, because what it shows is that even when you look at the various forms of intimate partner violence, psychological aggression, physical aggression, sexual coercion, Black men are comparable to female groups in the United States by 1.62, right, as an odds ratio. So basically, they're one and a half times more likely to experience that. And that's fascinating to me. How does a male category surpass female groups in terms of what we think of as feminine violence? It tells us something about our categories not making sense, right? That we have to adjust them, that we have to contour them. And that's what I think the reliance on the big data does that I can't get with the survey data. But that's not to lie the survey data. We've seen the power and potential of that for Black men and Black boys' stories especially to be heard. And the reason that we chose that around sexual violation and sexual abuse is because no matter how much data I show people about sexual debut in this country between the ages of 9 and 14 for Black men and boys, they don't care. it's like no matter how much data I show people, well, look, here's all the, you know, the differentiations and da da da, doesn't move.
That's where, forgive that, I do want to interrupt and have you double back and elaborate and say again. Because just in that last response, which is very interesting and detailed and fascinating, it almost comes out so smoothly this but what I don't think hits or is well understood or accepted in the broader response to the work, particularly among those who hear about it but don't read it. This point you're making about the rates Black men and boys suffer violence in intimate, I forgot the phrase exactly how you put it, but in intimate personal relationships. Lay that out real quick, what the numbers are saying, how you've arrived at that, and what is being said there. Because again, I think as you've explained already, there is a tendency, and understandably, to say it is Black women and girls who are suffering the most.
Yeah, I never understand the most category, because we're both suffering. Like, the data doesn't suggest most, right? Like, none of the data says that, because what's the easiest way to explain it? When you look at big data sets, like produced by the CDC, there are two measures of prevalence. Prevalence simply means the amount of a illness or disease that happens in a population at a given time. So you can look at something like over the course of a lifetime, which is called lifetime prevalence, or you look at something over a course of 12 months. When you look at whether or not Black men or women experience higher rates of intimate partner violence over the course of their lifetimes, they are both the highest in their reference group. Black women, well, actually Black women are second, but Black women have an extremely high lifetime prevalence of intimate partner violence that I think they are in second place to Indigenous women, and Black men are highest of all groups of men in experiencing intimate partner violence over the course of their lifetime. You're looking at something that happens over 12 months. Black men have higher rates of 12-month victimization by intimate partner violence than Black women do, but the numbers are so close that it's not really significant. It could just be by chance. What that means is that when we compare those two things, it's not like Black women are the only ones getting beat up or abused. Black men are also getting beat up or abused. But then you have to look at something else. Well, let's look at child abuse, physical and sexual abuse within the homes. What's happening there? Well, Black boys are being sexually abused just as much as Black girls are. But then you're asking, well, then what kind of neighborhoods are these in? So you start looking at socioeconomic status and poverty. You find out that the neighborhoods have high rates of violence. So what you're seeing is you have violence in the community that makes it into the home, that makes it into the, affects the children, that affects the parents, right? This is how cycles of violence work. The conversation we've been having in liberal arts is one about who's the most oppressed, who's the most abused, who's the most victimized. And the reason that I really think that people in liberal arts don't cite data, or they selectively cite data, is because they don't want to deal with this problem. That you can't pull people apart. You can't pull groups apart, because we're not like white people. And this day, and you know, what the systematic review that I'm completing for my dissertation really does show is that even going back to the 1970s, when all this stuff started being cataloged, you had high rates of Black women killing their husbands. Like Black women from 1976 to 1993 killed Black husbands more than Black husbands killed Black wives. And nobody knows why. It's just there in the data. So you have people writing about this like Hampton that says, look, there was a 43% decrease in Black husbands killing Black wives and a 33% increase from 75 to 85 of Black wives killing Black husbands. Can't explain it. It's just there, right? You see the same thing happening in the 2000s. You see high rates of intimate partner homicide. Black men are killing Black women slightly more, roughly 250 to 290. Black women are killing Black men roughly 100, 150, 175, depending on the year. These are communal problems. And what I keep trying to tell people, what I'm trying to show people with the data, because you can look this up, right? It's not like it's some secret thing. You can just go through the data sets and find it, is that we've bought into a certain notion of causality that's linked to masculinity that white scholars don't even buy into anymore. And that's a really important theoretical point. Black people are arguing between each other about toxic masculinity and patriarchy causing intimate partner violence and homicide. The white people like Michael P. Johnson, who pushed this theory in the 1980s, abandoned it in 1995, and now came up with new taxonomies like intimate terrorism to talk about how it's not patriarchy that causes it, but there's certain different social determinants that breed violence in relationships, and he thinks that most of these people are men. But then you have other people that are fighting against that, like, you know, Douglas and Hines, who are saying, well, look, let's go test it. And they find high perpetration rates, especially amongst white women. You see, white people are making tons of money and getting grants by the government to study themselves in nuanced ways that are looking at how the conflicts in their families and their communities are causing them to be violent. We're taking it upon ourselves to argue and demonize each other with silly theories developed in 1982 by a white woman who died in the 1990s that said her theories were false and they made them off of jingles. But that's what we, this is what Elizabeth Penn said. You know, this is in chapter three, right? You remember how the Penn quote? Where Penn, where she says, look, this wasn't based on any science. We made this up. So the whole notion that patriarchy causes it to a partner violence, the person that created the theory, it was Ellen Pence and Michael Paymar, literally says, hey, we just made it up. And it sounded good, so we went with it. And you have Black scholars today fighting each other, using decadent white theories that a white woman made up and recanted on before she died a year or two later, being the basis of how we do Black intellectual thought, as if that's somehow liberatory. When white people are getting big government grants and having institutes to study how being beat as a child, whipped as a child, exposed to violence as a child causes intimate partner violence and intimate partner victimization. So they're creating programs and policies to actually reduce violence in their communities and homes. And we're up here demonizing each other because of our identities based on the theory of white person recanting. And this is why the tone of the man not is so dismissive towards it, because it's empirically silly. It's not based on evidence. It's not based on any understanding of correlation, causation, or social determinants. And it's certainly not based on any serious reading of the theoretical assets or works that even the white theorists that do the work are calling it from. So we're imitating our oppressors in the worst way when they're getting paid to actually solve violence, and we're condemning each other and not getting any work, because despite how many Black men you take out of communities, violence doesn't decrease. Mm-hmm. And nobody stopped for one moment and said, well, why is that? I mean, think about it. You have 1.5 million Black men that are missing, according to New York Times. Black men's red zones are between the ages of 18 and 35. That's usually the times that Black men get married. Black marriage has decreased amongst the Black community, certainly falling later in the path. And we still have disproportionate rates of violence. So how many Black men do you have to take out of the community and the home or kill before violence rates decrease within homes and neighborhoods? You see, the causal mechanism doesn't make any sense. If Black men were the ones causing all the violence, then we should see systematic decreases over the years that show that that's comparable to their disappearance or removal from the community. But we don't see that. And the reason we don't see that is because the Black women in the households are just as violent. The Black kids who are witnessing the violence grew up to become just as violent, right? We see cycles and repetitions of violence in areas that are poor, marginalized, and politically ostracized. And this is just the fact that you see, not, this isn't like a new theory, but if you actually read the clinical evidence, this is something that they've been arguing about for the last 20, 30 years. You actually see the exact same patterns of violence among same-sex couples, right? But we can't talk about that, right? Because to talk about that's misogynoir. To talk about that makes you a misogynist. To talk about that makes you a hotel. So we can't even use science or epidemiology to interrogate the failures of theory, because we've said the theory amongst Black intellectuals trumps evidence. Ideology trumps facts and research. Mm-hmm. So our work in domestic violence is 20 or 30 years behind the kinds of research that I can just pull up on any given day on the works that white people are doing on social determination and conflict resolution within families, right? Because that's just where we are right now. You know, and that's the frustration. The frustration is not that, you know, I mean, I would love to have actual debates with Black scholars on these issues. Not ideological. Let's talk about data sets. Let's talk about experience. Let's talk about surveys, and let's try to get somewhere. But I'm told that if we have these debates, that it's too violent. It's too silencing. Too erase. You know, erases too many people's voices and opinions. So we can't use science to actually study our people, and it's frustrating to me, because the more and more that we keep getting policy briefs from English professors, the more and more white people keep developing new systems of statistical analysis and policies that actually solve problems within their families and their communities. And we're left out of that debate. We're left out of that grant seeking activity.
Right. In fact, on that last musical note, it reminds us of Charles Murray, the same Charles Murray from Bell Curve. Mm-hmm. Came out of the book 2012 called Coming Apart, mm-hmm. The State of White America. And his argument there was that class stratification was what fracturing the white family, mm-hmm. right? And therefore the white republic. And mm-hmm. so to your point, that's the motive force for the way that their scholarship is looking to deal with their hemorrhaging.
Absolutely.
Without question.
But you see, this is what I'm saying, right? We've gone so far to the theoretical. And I say this as a philosopher. we've gone so far to the theoretical that even sociological processes of social organization, the hierarchy, don't matter anymore. You see, Murray's just flat out a racist. You know, I don't think anybody, the notion of a negative two Z score, what is it? Are we one or two standard deviations under white people? I forget. But it, let's say his Z score is roughly one, negative one or two. And so to suggest that, right, to suggest that and then say, well, one of the things that we know threaten our stability, right, is that we have to think about class orientation, IQ, and deviance, right? Because he thinks that lower IQ is probably responsible for deviance. So he wants, right, a cohesive social structure that can compensate for that, right? This is the failure. Now, we don't have to buy into the pseudoscience of the IQ, but don't we think it's a little strange, just a little bit strange, that the very same theories that we use to talk about Black men and boys today are the theories that were endorsed by people like Monahan and people that he was reading that endorsed IQ differentiation. And here's what I mean really quickly by that. We always talk about the Monahan report as an anti-Black woman doctrine, right? And I don't defend Monahan. I'm not one way or the other. But I doubt we've ever read the footnotes of Monahan, because the footnotes of Monahan are all the types of things that we say about Black men constantly. That Black men have no drive, that Black men don't have any educational aspiration, that Black men have lower IQs, right? That Black girls, he literally said, basically would say, Black girls have Black girl magic. We don't know what Black men are doing, all right? And see, it's those cumulative factors, not having aspiration, economic drive, et cetera. That's what he says, well, that's what causes a matriarchal society, and that's why Black people fail. The initial causation isn't that Black matriarchy leads to Black failure. The issue is you have all these Black men who are worth nothing, have low IQs, et cetera, that's pulling down the Black community. And it seems that every time I pick up a journal article in literary criticism or English lit, or I read something coming out of Black studies at certain elite institutions, or hell, I even click to Twitter, I see those kinds of arguments being made. That Black men are the most dangerous, that Black men are X, Y, and Z, et cetera. And what we've shown in the last several years is that much of the ways that we talk about gender theory, be it intersectionality, et cetera, really do rely on a lot of the criminology that was developed during this period of time, right? So roughly the mid-60s to the 1980s. And Black male studies merely wants to push back on that, not only with good history, right, you know, but also with empirical evidence and experientialism, right? Getting the experiences of Black men, looking at different factors of social deviance and getting rid of the intuitive causality arguments that Black men, simply because they're oppressed, want to be white men, and that's why they commit higher rates of violence, because that's just not true.
Right. Well, there are two things I want to pick up on.
Sure.
Excuse me. That I admire about the work. The first is about sexual violence. Mm-hmm. So I certainly admire the way that you examine the shifting definition of rape. Mm-hmm. And the problem that data collection on male rape presents. Mm-hmm. And so the first, you know, part of this two part is, what are the new developments on these fronts since 2007, when, you know, the book came out shortly thereafter. And the second part that I admire that you do is your reading of Eldridge Cleaver, Soul on Ice, yes, and Book of Lives.
Yes.
I read, yes, Soul on Ice. That was the second book I read cover to cover. The first book I read cover, mm-hmm, to cover that's appropriate for this program is Malcolm X's, well, Alvin Taylor's rendition of Malcolm, mm-hmm, X's autobiography. Yes. I want to make that clear. His rendition, yes, yes, of Malcolm's autobiography.
Yes, yes.
But Soul on Ice was the second one I read cover to cover, mm-hmm, as a teenager. And so I admire the rereading of Soul on Ice on Book of Lives. And you say of that Cleaver believed in the possibility of salvation, mm-hmm, you know, sort of within, you know, the facts of the anti-Black life.
Yeah.
So the question for that is, do you believe in this possibility? And if so, why?
Jesus. Okay. So, well, first, thank you.
First one is rape. The other one is.
Yeah. I got him in my head. Okay. I got him in my head. I was just, well, let me say that I think the sexual violence piece regarding Black men has been especially difficult, because there's been lots of developments across the world. Like, you know, I found out my book was being cited in Italy on sexual violence recently, because people are interested in male sexual victimization. But in the United States, it's a very, very difficult thing to get to, because, as you know, Black men are overdetermined by the idea of them being rapists. So we actually published a study that came out in Hobson's book, on edited book on Black masculinities. And, you know, what we had a, and, you know, Dr. Utley and I, you know, Ebony, a good friend of mine, great colleague, you know, we literally had to publish a study to refute the idea that became popular with bell hooks, that Black men didn't think or care about losing their virginity, mm-hmm. right? That their sexual debut was inconsequential. So we had, what, I think, 7 or 8 stories where we interviewed Black boys about their first times, and they talked about their nervousness, how they wanted to have their sexual debut or initial intercourse with friends because they were emotional and they were insecure, except, you know, we had to do a whole study just to push back on something without a footnote. Mm-hmm. And that tells us something, because, you know, bell hooks never use footnotes. So it tells us something about the kinds of demonization that Black men have in the imagination of different people. So I think that there's been tremendous gains over the last several years in understanding male sexual victimization, but unfortunately not with Black men. I think that's still an ongoing battle, right? The Cleaver piece, I'm glad you like that chapter. I mean, that's one of my favorite chapters, to be honest with you. Because again, this, it really does go to the theme of the book, is that nobody wants to touch Cleaver. Mm. Like, Cleaver is the boogeyman for Michelle Wallace. He's the boogeyman for, you know, Gloria Steinem. He's the boogeyman for Black feminists everywhere, right? You know, he's the man that, he is the rapist. And I didn't do it to be provocative. I know, you know, somebody accused me once of being provocative and defending Cleaver. And I could tell they didn't read the book, because that's not what I'm doing. But I think it's so powerful to talk about Cleaver through his own eyes, right? Of how he saw his own love affairs, how he saw his own sexuality, and how he saw the prison industrial complex. Because I think when we talk about mass incarceration, we talk about the effects of mass incarceration. We talk about its industrial, capitalistic brutality and torture. And that's fine and well, but as you know, that becomes cliche-ish after a while. I wanted to engage in what a Black man saw Black men becoming in the prison. And I found tremendous resources in what Eldridge Cleaver was saying about that problem, of how a Black man is turned into a convict, and what the prison walls actually do to Black men as they store their bodies. And, you know, his love affair with Little Richard, I think, I mean, it's been like 4 years, so forgive me, but I think I actually wrote in there, I was like, we shouldn't be distracted, mm-hmm. right, by his sexual affairs mm-hmm. with Little Richard, because he, as he says in his book, he loved Little Richard, right, or Little just Jesus. And what actually happens with him and Little Jesus then is Cleaver, as a gay Black man, looking at the transformation of other Black men, given that the prison is kind of a homoerotic generator, mm-hmm. right? Because it puts Black men's flesh, it puts their penises on display. It, even in the chapel where the guards are white, are hearing other men have sex with other men, right? He's like, this is all for their enjoyment. Mm-hmm. And that's why he has that very provocative statement, right? That, you know, the real question of revolution is really a question about who Black men are having sex with. Mm-hmm. It's policing who Black men have sex with. And I find that incredibly profound, mm-hmm. because I know if I take that quote out and don't say it's by Eldridge Cleaver, say it's by Foucault, people are immediately interested. Mm-hmm. Like, what do you mean? How is revolution overlooked? Mm-hmm. Right, this problem. But you say that it's from a Black man who was taught that he was a rapist, mm-hmm. then embraced the notion of rape, then rejected it, mm-hmm. then was in love with another man, but then wanted to reconfigure how we have sexual intercourse altogether as revolutionary. Nobody wants to listen to him, right? So yeah, so I thought Cleaver represents something and plays with how we as academics, as scholars, truly have the ability to reconceptualize categories and figures, right? I thought that chapter does a good job. And I wanted to take down Wallace, because I think Wallace's work is ridiculous. And Cleaver just gives you a great example to do that, because, you know, and this goes back to what I was saying at the beginning, like, I don't know why are we using work that people have already retracted, recanted, been disproven as the basis for how we do theory? Mm-hmm. I don't understand. Like, she's written 2 pieces saying, I don't believe this. One, the last piece was, a white woman forced me to do it. You know, I didn't write it. Because I quoted it extensively. And then then after her mom's book came out, I even quoted her Amazon response to her mom's book, mm-hmm. where she was like, y'all, it's great to see that my mom still has this view of the Black macho. I don't believe anything I've ever wrote. It was a terrible book. And we're still up here like, oh, well, this is the intervention, the beginning of Black feminist. This is silly, right? And to the last question, you know, I mean, it depends on what day you get me on, brother. Is I think, you know, and this is, you know, another Black male studies scholar, Mike Sawyer, he's at Pitt now, wrote a book on Malcolm X, where he uses X, the name of the book is Black Minded. And he uses the book to answer that very same question. And I get there, of course, through Derek Bell's work. When I look at the trends of violence amongst Black people, I have moments of pessimism and then hope. The reality of the situation is that we know that the violence that we see, that the reasons, the things that we say about each other on Twitter are actually in the minority of how we relate to each other. And we know that those things have sociological or ecological factors. But there is not going to be freedom. There is nothing, you're a historian, so you know, there's nothing historically that suggests to us that unless we could assimilate, right, that a culture, like a people like ours can simply be okay in a system or a geography that continuously tries to dominate and exterminate them, right? In most situations this happens, either the group has to flee, they have to intermarry, or they die. And I think those are hard facts to deal with, but when we look at the course of history, that's what we get. If we're looking at contemporary sociological evidence, like we don't want to buy into historical determinism, and we want to look at sociological evidence, then we see a very clear split between the trajectories, both economically and politically, for Black men and Black women. Black men are having sharp downward mobile issues, and Black women are basically moving up, right? So this suggests to us that the notions of integration or incorporation don't operate the same way for Black men, both in terms of education, life expectancy, all the major markers of demographic health are not looking good for us.
Right.
So that forces me to then ask the question that I've been developing since the Man Out, which is it better or is it more appropriate to understand anti-Black racism as a form of misandric aggression? Meaning, are there certain mechanisms within white patriarchal capitalistic societies that prevent racialized men from incorporating into those societies the same way that other groups and their female counterparts can? And once we start researching that question, then that's when we get into the work of people like Earl Miller, Jim Sedanius, et cetera. And as you know, the answer is no. Right. So if I take the most objective kind of way to engage this question, despite my wish for there to be some ways for us to reform the system without tremendous loss of life, where the notions of possibility remain purely existential. They're not political. They're not going to be programmatic. Now, unless like it's something like the economy or the government falls, that's a different ballgame. But certainly within our current apparatus and structure, I don't see possibility being transformed or changed in ways that I think that many of the people we discuss and become popular in the academy do.
Right.
In fact, I would go so far as to argue that the popularity of certain Black academics, you know, the New York Times bestsellers list people, we can measure their, or we can certainly gauge their propensity for success based on how much they sell white people that dream that there's going to be transformative change that starts with white people. But nothing we have empirically, I don't care what data set you look at that I've seen, and I think that any other social sciences that seems from Darity all the way forward, even the guy at, what's the guy at Harvard, Chetty, he won the Bates Medal. Even the stuff he's coming out with, economic opportunity, you know, and downward mobility, none of it's positive, Matt. So I don't know where that hope would come from besides kind of a Hail Mary, you know. Right. So yeah, that's a long way of me saying I don't think the possibility of transformation is as strong as someone as Cleveland would have seen with Black power during that period of time. I just don't think it's structurally possible now.
Appreciate it very much. Jared, how are we doing on time and the...
Well, we are at just over the halfway point, and I've been copying down a bunch of good questions from the audience, the chat. So I'm happy to work them in if you got, I know, I think Kwasi's got, a whole bunch more. Let me just squeeze one in while I'm actually talking. Let me just squeeze one in that I'm just going to cobble together from a couple things I've seen. The note I wrote here is Angela Davis versus Angela Davis. And the point is that it seems that the way you bring up Angela Davis, it seems to contradict the way she seems to be deployed in this conversation in the public, discourse, so to speak. That is, when you reference her work, it's to remind that she criticized this idea that Black men were, given power over, through the process of enslavement over women. And yet in the public discourse, she seems to be deployed to make a different point. And I don't know to what extent that's her fault or just a sort of misreading or mislistening to her over the years, or both and. Okay.
Yeah. I mean,
And let me just tag on to that this other part of the question, which is where it has been asked: to what extent was the negative experience of Black men on the plantation through buck breaking and rape, et cetera, to what extent does that play a role in today's relationships with intimate partner relationships?
One second. Yeah, can you hear me?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think my headphones died. Well, let me say the Angela Davis piece first. I think that, like anything else, when Davis was writing that, she was very much influenced by a set of Black radicals that looked at history and slavery much differently than people would after the 80s and 90s. So I think when she wrote that in 1971, the role of Black women during slavery, she very much was going on the best historical data analysis they had at the time, which was that because slavery was created by patriarchs, they wouldn't allow other people they thought to be inferior to be patriarchs. And this was a popular argument amongst Marxist feminists well into the 1980s. You know, what ends up happening, though, is you see Angela Davis having a very different persona now. She's not talking about Black power ideology. She's not talking about Black power structural analysis. I think this is where Angela Davis departs quite strongly from someone like a Sylvia Winter that seems to be very popular for everybody. Because Winter is very clear that her intellectual genealogy starts with the Black arts movement and the Black power movement, right? And she sees questions of the human being raised from that kind of genealogy and that kind of history. So Davis has become popular. She rarely presents papers. She mostly kind of gives, you know, orations and commentaries and thoughts about things. And that's well within her right. But again, I think there's a difference between doing the scholarly work that academics are employed and charged to do, and then doing the kind of celebrity intellectual thing. And that's certainly not to discredit, you know, Angela Davis. It's simply to say, you know, given her age and, you know, her notoriety, her focus has changed. So yeah, in very many ways, I think you're right. What she wrote back in the 70s directly contradicts what she's been saying, at least since Occupy Wall Street, right? Concerning questions of gender, et cetera. On the larger point, however, I think that this is where gender theory takes a shift, and it's not really based on the empirical anymore, right? Like if slavery is the basis of Black dehumanization and certain patterns, this is the problem that I have with Afro-pessimism in some regards. So if Blackness is the slave, and our condition is contemporary slavery, I should be able to look at slavery and then match it up with certain institutions and practices today, because they're supposedly unchanging at the ontological level, right? The same concepts of being are the same. Yet, when we say that and we discover things like, oh, Black men were raped or Black men were eaten and all this other terrible things that happened to Black men, somehow you don't want to extend that analysis to what's happening right now when cops are anally penetrating Black men with batons, screwdrivers, and guns. So it seems that the ideology of gender becomes selective. We have a notion from Saida Hartman, well, the Black woman is slave, so from slavery to now, that's why she's been so dehumanized, that's why she's been so oppressed. We try to do the same thing with Black men, and it becomes incongruent. Black men were oppressed. Black men were eating. Black men were raped. Oh, but now that doesn't happen. They have privilege. So our ideology is framing the ways that we see the direct relationship between what happened in slavery and now based on gender differentiation. I personally argue that you can see clearer connections between what happened in slavery. And I don't know why we always forget Jim Crow, but Jim Crow and today. So most of the things that we see about Black men actually originated, all the ideas roughly came about from 1920 to 1970. You know, most of the stuff that we're debating, like toxic masculinity, hegemonic masculinity, you know, rape, these theories were generated in the 60s, 70s, maybe with street culture, you go back to the 40s. That's generally where you're pulling this stuff from. So there's a very real connection between what's coming out of slavery in 19th century ethnology and then what's being birthed in American sociology. So it's definitely connected.
Mm-hmm. I feel like I've gotten myself in enough trouble with the Afro pessimism thing lately. Because I haven't read Hartman that closely at all, so I can't. But when I read or talk to Frank Wilderson, I hear him saying exactly what you just said, because that's exactly what I think about the relationships. To me, have not changed. Mm-hmm. The same. It's more nuanced or sophisticated, but not changed. I don't want to derail.
I get myself in trouble all the time because for me these are arguments and they deserve interrogation. Like I rather like Wilderson's diagnosis. I disagree with him about the ontological and metaphysical implications of the system. But it's the same thing that critical race theorists have been saying for decades. So, I mean, it'll be contradictory of me to argue otherwise. Mm-hmm. But what I do find interesting is the way that identity somehow plays a role in Wilderson's newest accounts of Afro-pessimism. So if Davis is correct, right, that there were no sex differences on the plantation besides for rape, right? So women did the same work that men did. Men weren't considered patriarchs because the slave master wouldn't allow patriarchy to rise under that system. And then, so the difference between men and women are their vulnerability to rape. I find out that rape happened to men. What's the basis of gender differentiation today? Because these are ontological arguments. A equals A, right? What if I'm the slave and slave has no gender besides the violence imposed on rape, which is what Saida Hartman's argument is about the woman, then once I find out that the man is raped, then what gender differences or sexual differentiation can possibly emerge?
Okay, so maybe that's what I'm not getting in Frank's work, because I don't see him making that differentiation in his work.
No, he doesn't. He doesn't. So then what role then can sexual differentiation ever play within this system? The slave's always just a slave, right? Does the slave have gender?
So you're saying there should be a differentiation?
I'm saying that if we buy the Wilderson's theory, there would be none. No. Mm-hmm. Well, I would say Wilderson's.
But I'm hearing you say that there isn't any. I'm reading and hearing you say that there isn't any, and that the differentiation is falsely imposed. I'm saying that
Wilderson would have to agree.
Right, I think he does. And when I read your work, I don't see his work disagreeing with you. That's why I'm like, what is going on here?
No. But what I'm saying is how people interpret. I'm saying we would agree. We get there from different ways.
Gotcha.
But when people try to pick up Afro-pessimism, they fit it into their contemporary identity.
I see. Sorry about that. Got you.
And what I'm saying is this is what I mean by the misreadings and misapplications of theory.
Got you.
Such that no matter what the force of the actual argument is, it ends up being whatever works for our kind of woke-divism 101 by politics. Right. So what I'm saying is that when you look at the power of Wilderson's argument, I don't believe in a metaphysical system, but if that's the case, then it naturally follows that the slave could not be gendered in the kinds of ways that we think are compatible with queer theory, trans theory, etc. Because the slave is just the base level of dehumanization. We all gonna die. The body's gonna be used for whatever it is. So the concept of the woman, as attractive and sexy as that may seem, doesn't exist. Because Black men and Black women are treated the same. But we don't want to say that, right? He doesn't, you know, I've heard him talk about his book. I've read his book and I've heard what he said. He doesn't want to say that in certain instances. I understand why.
I got you.
Right? But, you know, I say it. because it's true, right? Like, you know, for me, I'm about arguments, and people don't seem to like that. So what I'm trying to show, though, is we, as Black scholars, we seem to be beholden to a different standard of consensus and popularity and public acceptance,
right,
in our theories, despite what we write. And the brilliance of Wilderson's theory is that the diagnosis is so brazen and caustic that it forces you to pay attention. And that's why I tell people, even if I disagree with the ontological or metaphysical picture that Wilderson's drawing, because I think there's other room. I think Moden is correct. There's more considerations to be had existentially or aesthetically. I still have to respect the brilliance of the force of the argument, right? I have to entertain the argument. But what ends up happening, though, is that because the argument's so forceful and it's so, right, it just hits you on the head, now we got to start making apologetics for different groups that feel excluded from the argument, right? Mm-hmm. And the difference between Afro-pessimism and Black male studies, because it's data-driven, is not making apologies to anybody, right? Because it's saying that when we look at the conditions, the look at the historical picture, look at the sociogenic picture, there's no need to adjust for the realities that we keep seeing repeat over and over and over again. So you can pick any category of violence, and if you're talking about extermination, you're talking about men. If you're talking about genocides, you're talking about men. If you're talking about segregation, you're talking about harsher penalties for men. That's not because they're my favorite group. That's just because that's the way that patriarchal societies since the beginning of time seem to operate. And what we've done is we've said, well, a lot of people don't like that argument, so let me adjust it. Let me make it sound better so that people can buy into it and I can get fans. But that takes away from the strength of the evidence. And what I'm saying is that because Black male studies has no doubt that it's willing to stand on evidence and have actual scholarly debates, that's what leads to, I think, some of the kinds of arguments that you get on Twitter or the kind of ad hominems, because there's not a way around people making apologies for things that are very squarely rooted in historical, sociological, epidemiological fact and record.
Again, the only thing I would say is that all I understand Frank to be doing is offering a theory that would attempt to interpret your data.
Oh, absolutely. I don't see we're in agreement about that point.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right. That's all I want to say. I'm
not talking about Frank.
Yeah.
No, I got you. Yeah. I'm also just saying that to. I'm just thinking out loud. Trying to work this out because I'm just holding on here. That's all I'm trying to do. Go ahead, Kwasi, man. I know you want to come back in, and then I will come back in a second. And work in another question from the crowd.
Sure thing. I'll try to package these in. I'm really loving the conversation. So, I guess as the historian. There's nothing that I know of in world history where a group of bonded captive people who are largely prisoners of war, mm-hmm. Whether you think of it as slavery as a continual war, which there's some scholarship for that, including Vincent Brown's recent book about Taki's Revolt, mm-hmm. or you think about it existentially in terms of whether you declare formally or not a war against a certain set of group of people. Either way, there's no evidence that I've seen so far in world history of any captive or bonded people being fully integrated on their terms in their mm-hmm. captive society. It hasn't mm-hmm. happened yet. And there's no historical evidence to make a leap of faith to suggest that it might happen. Now, of course, that has political, all kinds of economic and social implications, right? here's the historical question then, Tommy. Why do you start the story, or at least in Manhood, mm-hmm. given when it was came out, why does the story of enslaved Black male begin in the 1830s, mm-hmm. thereabout? And I ask that because sort of looking at the Americas, or the region called the Americas, roughly 13 plus million Africans are documented to cross the Atlantic on a one-way voyage. About 45% land in the Caribbean basin, mm-hmm. 40% in Brazil, if you do the sort of the tabulations, about 10% in South Central America, and about 4 or 5%, in the United States. Mm-hmm. Two-thirds of these unconsensual voyages were male. mm-hmm. particularly the 19th century, which you do focus on, at least 30% were boys, were children, right? So the demography, you know, really is, it shifts, you know, and dramatically. And of course, we know that Africans are being trafficked into the continent of the United States past 1865, mm-hmm. you know, whether Mississippi and Natchez, right, or, you know, other parts of the Deep South.
Yeah, different port cities. Yeah.
Right, right. Folks are still being trafficked in. So just want you to just think about and share with us, you know, how does Black Men Studies handle the sort of the demography, right? You know, who's mm-hmm. coming, who's landing, who's there on these plantations, right? Or mining district or urban communities. How does Black Men Studies, you know, respond to sort of these demographic numbers that we can actually, that's been cataloged for those that are recorded? Now, granted, that means
we know,
lots that we don't know and never will know, sure. right?
No, I think they respond the same way, right? What was the use of bringing in predominantly men in some cases, young boys, right? What was the extraction of labor? What was the assumptions about that? Is there a need to, and this is why I'm so interested in historiography, right? What do we have to change about our understandings of the Black family or even about capitalism, given the ways that Black men's bodies were specifically used and interpreted? You know, to me, Black male studies, it doesn't take an ideological stance. It's trying to open up new venues of inquiry, right? So and that's why I tell people all the time, like, I wasn't interested in like a Black masculinism or something. There's not a political stance here. I'm saying that when we start looking at facts, we have a whole bunch of new questions and theories that we get to start asking about what actually happened. And this is actually why I started in the 1830s. Mm-hmm. My research interest in strong suit is largely from physiognomy in the late, 18th century and how it extends into the 19th century. And then, of course, into, you know, the social sciences of the 20th century. Mm-hmm. So for me, I was interested in, well, like, when did Black people, specifically Black men, become incorporated into the white family model, right? Mm-hmm. So the ontogeny of how white families grew was the basis of patriarchy. And I think, you know, lots of 19th century historians certainly agree on that when they're looking at the growth of patriarchy, its relationship to nature and evolution. So I wanted to figure out, if patriarchy is going to be my central question here, when did it start affecting Black people? Like, when did they start getting integrated and understood within the family structure, the nuclear family, et cetera? So, you know, I was looking at the literature around domestic slavery at the early 1800s. I was like, hey, I don't want to go all the way back to the 1400s. That's outside of my wheelhouse. I'm going to stick to my strengths. Let's do this 19th century, you know, late 18th, 19th century ethnology thing. Mm. And I found it immensely educational and in my view, helpful. Because I think that when we talk about patriarchy, we forget that it had a starting point. We forget that it was a very specific hierarchy that grew out of European needs, you know, both capitalistically and in terms of inheriting property and protecting families on frontiers, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Right. And for me, that was an interesting debate to have because I learned about how white women saw themselves within patriarchal family structures. Mm-hmm. And I think the big hint from chapter one is, yeah, they didn't think of themselves as oppressed whatsoever. Mm-hmm. And of course, since then, I've gone in much greater detail about how white women and white feminists and suffragettes thought about themselves in relationship to white male power. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's a conversation that nobody was having 4 or 5 years ago. You know, mm-hmm. it was me saying, well, look, what's the strongest way I could pose this argument that I know if I go back into the history, mm-hmm. I'm going to be able to defend this not only on the scientific basis of ethnology, but also in the relationships or what's influencing these women thinking, right? Because, you know, I basically do intellectual history. And I found that to be the most approachable task. But I leave it to material historians to go through the archives and really deploy different ways of looking at the place that Black men and specifically Black male bodies had within the configuration of chattel slavery. Because look, we find the same thing in the Yellow Peril, right? Like, they brought over a whole bunch of Asian men, you know, and the question we have to ask ourselves is why, mm-hmm. right? And as you know, with the Yellow Peril, mm-hmm. you know, the idea was basically that you're going to work them to death and they weren't going to be allowed to reproduce, mm-hmm. you know? So like, what is it about this idea? Cause we see the same thing with the super predator mythology, right? What is it about using male bodies to get labor and capital from, mm-hmm. and then hoping they die out so they don't reproduce themselves? right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, even when you look at Dorothy Roberts' book, Killing the Black Body, she talks about the process of sterilizing Black women. Mm-hmm. But you look at all the criminological discussions around the times of the 80s and 90s, they were criminalizing Black women because they didn't want Black women to birth little Black boys. You know, like, they're explicit about this, right? Wolfgang and Farrakuti are not playing. Like, the people that they train are very clear that Black men are going to lead to the doom of American civilization. Mm-hmm. So I'm interested in what does it mean for us to start thinking mm-hmm. about misandrial regression, our anti-Black misandry, and Black men within a Black male studies paradigm. Mm-hmm. Like, what new sets of questions or interpretations are possible?
Right.
And in that sense, I think it's quite empowering because, I mean, if we're being honest, I mean, when was the last time we had a major intervention into how Black people are debating gender theory,
mm-hmm.
right? Like, when we think about Black queer studies or even Black trans studies, we see them as derivatives of a certain kind of supposition about Black feminism. We have not had the kinds of moves in Black gender theory that we got, you know, that white people got from, say, like R.W.S. Connell's work or Judith Butler's work, for instance, right? Mm-hmm. We largely integrated those theories into how we read Black people. But who's to say that they're actually true? This is a theory that we know is empirically true that has theoretical legs because it was written by a philosopher.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's you know, and like I said, I'm willing to stake my career on the fact that we can ask certain sets of questions. We can use it as an interpretive lens to open up new debates. And it's like anything else. In 10 or 15 years, if people are like, no, look, we got new evidence, new archives, this isn't what happened, then yeah, you know, refute me and put me in a corner. Mm-hmm. But for right now, right, it's undeniable that Black male studies has presented new forms of evidence that have not yet been considered within mm-hmm. the archive or the intellectual genealogy of what we've considered to be gender sexuality studies amongst Black people in the United States. Mm-hmm.
That's great, because that actually leads into the next question. Then Jared may have a few lined up. So you write throughout The Man Not, the book The Man mm-hmm. Not, about the vulnerability and the victimhood of Black boys and men.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, you argue for their sufferings to be theorized and accounted for in the disciplines. But for what ends?
Mm-hmm. For their end, to be quite honest. I think I'm pretty sure I say this in a book, and if I don't, I know I say it in a couple articles. I don't think that Black male studies is there to save, you know, or transform the world where people recognize Black men as human and, you know, they become citizens and, you know, can move through the world like their Black female counterpart and educate. I don't think that's true. All the evidence on site says that's not true for very specific reasons. But I'll be very honest with you. To this very day, I still get messages. I got a message today from a Black woman who reached out to me because, you know, she said she was worried about, you know, I believe it was her close friend. I said he was posting suicidal ideas and she was like, you know, could I talk to him, et cetera. And I told her, look, this is a mental health crisis. You really need to, you know, get him serious help.
Mm-hmm.
And I get messages like that all the time. I got messages from brothers saying that they've been hurt, that the world's beating them down, and they read the book and it made it feel, you know, feel better. It made them understand. It gave them some detachment from believing that they were pathological. And I wrote the book for that, mm-hmm. right? And I wrote the book so that Black men don't have to accept pathology as the starting point of how they start thinking about themselves. And I've been very adamant and clear. That's exactly what I find a lot of the literature, like Bell Hooks' work, you know, some of the work, if people read the footnotes by Crenshaw, right? That's what that work does. Because what it says is you come from a population with these decadent and toxic ideas, right? That, you know, you think you're a man and being a man is synonymous with violence. But none of the ethnographies that are interviews that we have with Black men say that. There's not a record of any interview where Black men say that they think about their manhood as being synonymous with being able to hurt people. And I want to understand that gap. Why is it, you know, when I was in grad school, one of the books, you know, I was just interested in gender theory. So I took lots of Black feminism classes. I took lots of gender studies classes. And every time I wanted to study Black men, they would just give me either Lemon's book, Mark Anthony Neal's book, or Bell Hooks.
Mm-hmm.
And every time I read these books, I was constantly confronted with the idea that there's something wrong with Black men, right? They're hypersexual, they're violent, they want to kill and oppress women. And I'm like, well, is there any other story? Is there any? And then when I asked questions about that story, people said I had to accept it because asking questions was evidence that I was a bad Black man. So when I wrote The Man Not, I was like, look, let's just talk about the evidence. Let's talk about the history. Let's ask different sets of questions, right? And I think that there is something about the very process of being able to think. And this is why I constantly talk about thinking in the unthought. There is something about Black men being able to think themselves that doesn't rely on thinking yourself through the caricature of someone else. And I'm surprised by this, but that seems to have some worth to Black men in the real world. Mm. Right. And it's amazing. Like I look on Amazon every now and then or Goodreads to see the reviews that people have the book, and they're all positive. Right. I have mothers that contact me, like, my son read your book. It's changed, you know. And I don't think I'm not trying to brag like, oh, that's great writing. It's something different. It's an opportunity that I think Black men have not had to think about themselves. Like, look, we're not perfect, but damn it, we're human, right? We're not, we've never been perfect. Nobody's made that argument. Some of us are violent. Some of us are depressed. Some of us are suicidal, but we don't have to start with that as the basis of interpreting ourselves. We don't have to start with the pathology. And I don't think we've had the ability to do that. I mean, brother, look, I can make the same argument about any other racial group in the country. If I wanted to pick Black women, I could talk about domestic abuse, child abuse, suicide rates, or in general rates of defense compared to any other woman group. But the whole thing with Black feminism is like, why do we start there? Right? We don't start with the negative because we know the negative are products of certain historical circumstances and conditions. Right? You can't put us in the most wretched conditions and expect us to miraculously represent the best of what you think we've been to not. But when we do the same thing for Black men, we have no problem saying that lower class Black men who've been brutalized, who've been exposed to violence as young children, who've been physically and sexually abused, who've been locked up, high rates of recidivism, alcohol, drugs, that's masculine. That's real Black masculinity. Right? Because that's where you find all these rates of violence. You don't find it in brothers that are making above 50 to 75,000 a year. That's certainly not what the data says, right? So why do we take the worst of us as the starting point for thinking about us? And that's what The Man Not is trying to challenge, right? It's giving Black men something that says, look, you can't run away from the problems that affect us. You can't run away from the violence that we do perpetuate and perpetrate in some instances. But that's not the totality of Black manhood. It's not the totality of what we are. So what happens if we start thinking in those spaces of the positivity, of the coping mechanism, of the resilience, right? And we recognize these are products of our environment, then what things become possible? And that small question has seemed to open up and light the way for so many young Black men and scholars as well.
Indeed. In fact, before I let Jerry come back in with a number of questions from the chat, as you were speaking, is the last maybe 30 seconds, what came to mind, you know, to capture not all, but a lot of the strands that you spoke to and even animated was the film Antoine Fisher, one of my favorites. Yes. Because it captures a lot of thematic, a lot of those threads. And mm-hmm. when that film came out, I remember the lack of attention and notoriety and for mm-hmm. Denzel's acting and his directorship, you know, of that. But I thought that was one of the most powerful films.
Except it falsely painted an image of what happens with Black men in the Navy. So that was my problem with the film.
I was like, hold up.
I was like, what? Where was this dude when I was in the joint? I didn't see this brother nowhere.
You missed out, man.
And clearly, I was like, damn, he was like the only one.
Finding Fish, you know, the name of the book, the autobiography, right?
Yeah.
Finding Fish was actually one of my inspirations to pursue The Man Not. So in the sequel, I'm actually going to talk about how reading Finding Fish really did inspire me to think of these positive images. Because, you know, brother, you know, it's so funny because I think now the conversation 4 years later is just so different than the conversation Jared and I had in the very beginning. Because you know, Jerry, there was nothing there, brother. Like, even now, the debates that we see, I think we see on Twitter and in the academy, are very different because there's a pushback against some of the insistence of Black men as privileged and toxic, et cetera. You know, and I hear about, even though I'm in Europe, I hear about, you know, the constant issues of that all the time. But 4 or 5 years ago, there was no pushback. There were no other sources or debates where Black men could stand toe to toe with feminists or Black feminists, et cetera, to refute the argument, not just about how they feel, but concretely refute the argument.
That's why you had to go to Europe to launch this argument to have it take place over here.
Hey, it is what it is.
I can't even be over there and get into conversation. Anyway, my bad. Go ahead.
But it says so much though, right? Like, you know, in Europe, they actually want to hear about how Black men suffer. Because, you know, I'm lecturing in Berlin, Amsterdam, you know, I go everywhere talking about Black male studies, talking about the issues that affect Black people, you know. And there's not the kind of resistance, there's not the kind of commercialization of Black thought in Europe as there is in the United States. You know, like in the United, I understand it, but I don't like it. If a Black woman comes to me and says she wants to tell me her story, right? Even if I know some aspects of the story are not all the way in line with certain forms of evidence, you know, it doesn't mean we don't gain something from listening to that story and that experience, right? I mean, I think the generalization is going to be a problem, but outside of that, I have no antagonism to hear a Black woman talk about her frustrations and her pain of living in this world. But when we talk about Black men and boys, well, somehow somebody's always upset. I mean, literally, I literally give titles of paper, somebody's mad. I'm talking about a story, you know, like the paper that Dr. Utley and I published on She Touched Me. These are stories of young men talking about being victims of sexual violence. And people are still mad about it. You know, there's no way around that, right? So what I think is that we have a situation
Before you finish that thought, let me squeeze this question in, because I think you might be able to address this question that I'm just now seeing as you start to answer and elaborate on where you were just going. Could you expand on the emphasis on recognition for Black men in relation to police killings? You wrote about this in your recent essay, He Never Mattered. It seems like this issue of recognition. I was quickly trying to draw a parallel as I was finding questions.
That essay is going to get me in trouble because that essay is actually it's in an anthology that they you know how they do the previews on Google Books, and for some reason this preview only has my whole essay in it. So you can read the whole essay on Google Books for free. But yeah, but I went in on Black Lives Matter, and I went in on them precisely because I don't understand how you can look at almost 200 or slightly over 200 Black men get killed per year, but us have an argument or a debate about who gets recognized as being killed the most, right? About, you know, who should be on the poster of time. I mean, the argument sickens me. And what I've said this since the beginning of BLM, is that this would be a movement where people buy and pay other Black people to decide which Black lives matter over others. And I find that to be just morally deplorable. So in that essay, my argument about recognition is one that recognition doesn't save lives, because if Black men are being recognized too much and they still die the most, then I don't know what we're arguing about. Recognition does not ameliorate police death. But two, and more importantly, is why are we playing Russian roulette with dead Black people, right? Why are we picking and choosing who gets to be seen and not seen, as if that somehow remedies the problem of us being killed? And I think that what happens in the academy is that we use recognition as a form of currency, as if that is an end in itself. And we're not actually worried about what happens to poor Black people and how their experiences actually get interpreted to white philanthropists in the Democratic National Party so that it benefits us. We're trying to launch other separate agendas. And I think that, you know, even when you look at the report that Crenshaw and Ritchie came out with, the AAFP or PF report, you know, that organization, it doesn't address concrete issues. It says it's interested in actual issues of sexual violence conducted by police, which I think is a fantastic idea. But as I said in that essay, we're not talking about all the Black men who have been victimized and raped and sodomized by police. we don't want to touch it. There's lawsuits with Mr. Campbell trying to get police prosecuted for sexual assault that's never mentioned in their report. We of course remember the Luima case, right? Yeah. Where a black man was anally sodomized. Why are these not images? Why are these not parts of the narrative of sexual victimization next to a hose cloth, right? Like these. I don't understand. The evidence and the phenomena suggest that black men and black women are affected by sexual violence from police. Black men and black women are affected disproportionately by domestic violence, but black men are consistently absent from that story, despite the fact that they have the most negative encounters with police over and over again, right? My criticism is that recognition has been used as some sort of metric by which we can sector out and divide black people, when in reality, we need to look at the facts, we need to look at the evidence, and we need to develop theories and political programs that are going to address how working class black people are disproportionately being killed and suffering from the types of things that organization says they're interested in. And
right on.
When theory doesn't match data, and when theory excludes certain forms of certain black people, we have to question it. And I can't emphasize that enough, because what I've really tried to push with black male studies isn't that we're bound into static categories of identity, but we're interested in certain social phenomena. So it happens that if I'm looking at police killings, or I'm looking at domestic abuse, or if I'm looking at suicides, I'm gonna find black men there most of the time by majority. That's what points me into the direction of the population I'm studying, not because I've made some a priori decision that I'm only focusing on black men. And that's actually one of the things that I'm constantly telling people on Twitter when they're like, oh, you don't include gay black men, et cetera. I was like, well, it depends what I'm studying. If I'm talking about suicide, depression, of course I'm studying gay black men. They have some of the highest rates of and incidences of depression and internalized anxiety that you have in the black population, right? But if I'm looking at something like downward mobility, et cetera, maybe not, because they, lesser. The context matters. And I think far too often what we do is when we're studying race, we already pick our favorite population and we don't care about everybody else who's suffering. And what I'm trying to do is create a mechanism of inquiry where we can methodologically and epistemologically capture the suffering of all different groups of black people, but especially black men when they appear in the majority. And I think that that's a very powerful interpretive and theoretical tool that we need and have, given what we constantly see happening in our society today. Mm-hmm.
Sure. Hey, Kwasi, go ahead, man.
Sure. Well, on that last note about method and analysis, let me circle back to Oyewumi's study, which you cite often, of course, for good reason. Mm-hmm. Of course, as you know very well, her frame of reference for gender, in mm-hmm. quotation, the gender analysis is Yoruba language. Mm-hmm. And because this and other African languages, at least in West Africa that I'm aware of, are gender neutral, in that mm-hmm. they do not declare gender as German, French, Portuguese, Spanish mm-hmm. does, right? Mm-hmm. Meaning, what you are is more important than who you are, mm-hmm. right? In the declaration, in terms of the grammar of these languages. So my question is, why don't more scholars study such languages, African languages, as a way of reframing gender, race, and other culturally bounded or rooted discourses? It seems to me that fighting in gendered European languages, including English, seems like a theoretical and practical dead end.
Because you're right, and there's no money in it. No, but let's call it what it is, right? Even the criticisms of Oyewumi's book suggested that there is a certain notion of sexual differentiation in Yoruba language that she wanted to ignore for her argument, mm-hmm. right? And her response to that was simply that, well, when you look at the culture, when you look at how the people live and speak, it's the function, it's how they live, right? Mm-hmm. That makes a difference. And she especially says that in her new book on motherhood. Mm-hmm. She does not shy away from how women function and operate in African society, which is simply not compatible with what we get out of Western epistemology and metaphysics. Mm-hmm. But despite her brilliance, and I'm saying this just because I like her work, I like the intervention that she's made, right? Mm-hmm. Nobody talks about Oyewumi in our contemporary work, mm-hmm. right? We'll talk about Hartman, we may talk about her and we're having conversations about her and Lagunas, but nobody takes her work seriously in that way, right? Theoretically. But we cite Crenshaw all day, right? Like we select who we think's correct based on how we think it advances our academic career and cachet. It's not because she's insufficiently incorrect or correct, right? Is that we don't value the people who actually read her work, because they're not going to be at elite gender studies or Black studies department at top 20 or 30 institutions. And what I find to be most despicable about, you know, because I'm at a extremely elite white institution, right? But even here, you can tell that the kinds of theories that are embraced are the theories that you see embraced in the most elite American white institutions. They're not interested. They say they're interested in Black people, but they're not interested in Black people. They're not interested in what Black people are fundamentally writing and thinking about. So you can name drop Fanon, you can name drop Du Bois, you know, but you're not dealing with the same kinds of problems. Oyewumi's dealing with a problem where she says, well, look, you have a linguistic and epistemological system that is based on how you perceive a body. And you perceive a body and you think that tells you something about a whole history. So you see man and woman, you think patriarchy, domination, etc. And she's like, we're from a completely different culture. They never thought of you once, that for you to impose that view on us is actually a form of cultural and epistemic colonization. So much so that when African women tell you that's not how our men are, you say, oh, yes, it is, because that's how we see your men. Right?
Yeah.
And then we come back to America and you tell Americans, right? And this sentiment has certainly grown since I'm outside of America now. You tell Americans that you're wrong because you're looking at another group of people, and Americans insist that they're right. So there's the same kind of positionality about a Black America looking out at the rest of the world that we criticize Europeans for when they look at the rest of the world. Right, because we take our standards of Blackness, the metaphysical suppositions, to be the world, that the way that colonization actually works, completely ignoring the fact that when Black people are talking about colonization in Africa, they're talking about it from the perspective that there's still a majority Black societies with cultures and languages like Europe. So we make no adjustments to our conceptual scheme about this, right? And these are limitations. So Oyewumi, on one level, is just beyond what we can think about in the West. Because she has a culture and a language, right? Some that we're not working with in many cases. And two, she's criticizing and destabilizing what mainstream gender theory and feminism, and she said this herself, and feminism is saying about the universality of the gender construct. We're much more willing to accept this from Judith Butler's Gender Trouble, because it fits within a certain kind of white queer theory legitimacy in the academy than we are from Oyewumi, despite them basically making the same kind of argument. There is no universal woman, hence there is no universal man, and therefore patriarchy cannot be a universal phenomenon because the principles and building blocks don't exist. But when you point that out in something like The Man Not, which basically gives you a test case of a history of racialized men where they can't be patriarchs by the very definition of it, we reject it and we say that it's anti-woman, et cetera. Right. So this is an issue of the kinds of currency that institutions afford to certain kinds of literature, and largely the fact that Black people have been right for a very long time, but it's not until white people either say it or then basically pull an Elvis on what Black people think that other Black people start citing. But I cite her because I like her work. I think the first two chapters are brilliant, and I think it raises interesting questions about how the epistemology of seeing the body actually brings with it certain logical or metaphysical entailments about gender that we are not being honest about.
Right on. Jared?
Absolutely. Now that's, that was fascinating. You've talked a little bit about this, but there are some, I'm going to try to put these together because if I'm not mistaken, she dovetails with some of this critique of capitalism. So where does the role of capitalism fit into The Man Not and its analysis and the work of Harriet Fradd, if her work, I know of her through a left economic analysis related to like Richard Wolff and stuff like that. So I'm not even sure. So she has, as I'm aware, and I know of her, it is mostly only through YouTube and whatnot. And it's as far as I'm aware, her arguments are it's a probably a Marxist critique, anti-capitalist critique. But anyway,
I pride myself pretty much reading anything that people tell me I haven't read, but I have not run across Fred, so okay. I apologize. But
I mean, even you can't get to everybody. I mean, come on now.
No, that's true. That's true.
I mean,
but you
come
know.
On now. I mean, help us out here a little bit. God damn. you don't have to shame us all into the daggone.
Oh, no, bro. I didn't mean it that way.
I'm just messing with you. But the role of capitalism in your analysis specifically, what is it?
So, I mean, there are two ways that it operates. One is that I'm focused on poverty more so than the very idea of capitalism. Because I'm interested in the effects that poverty has on Black men and boys, right? And I'm more interested in a question of class mobility versus kind of class segregation, which is what I speak about explicitly in chapter 3. Because what I'm interested in is how we've isolated a certain group of people to an undercast or underclass. And I know we keep saying that around, you know, kind of the new Jim Crow system. But, you know, I don't think the new Jim Crow is exactly correct, because we're not just seeing Black men pulled out of labor participation and the economy because of prisons. That's certainly one reason. But we're also deeming them as ineligible for participation in labor markets. And this is why I'm so fascinated by the work of Chetty. I really like, Dr. Logan's work from Ohio State on these issues of racism and the economy and labor participation. I'm curious, I guess, how do Black men who exist in the very same society, very same neighborhoods, become marked for poverty and isolation in society, both politically and economically, more so than other groups of their race and of their economic class? And that's what the Man Knot's trying to figure out. And the secondary question from that is, well, if we can see this phenomenon of downward mobility of them being blocked out of certain sectors, both politically and economically for society, what kinds of ills does that create? So that's why I then say, well, you're going to see increases of sexual violence, depression, suicide, mental health issues, intimate partner violence, et cetera. So capitalism is an overarching framework I have for how I'm thinking about neighborhood interactions, poverty, and the kinds of social determinants that are created by economic deprivation. But I'm not really interested in having the argument about capitalism per se, because I think those are dead in arguments in the academy. Because the only frame that we use to evaluate capitalism is going to be Marxism. We're not talking about world systems theory. We're not talking about, you know, various forms of economic stratification. We're not talking about, you know, the ways that capitalism functions that require a very deep analysis of what it produces in various levels of neighborhoods, regions, et cetera. And those are the things that I'm fundamentally interested in. So I just find the best way to talk about that is through like epidemiology or public health issues than having a formal debate about theories of capital or, you know, neoliberalism, et cetera. And I say that, you know, with an eye that I know how it sounds, but I got to be honest, I'm sick and tired of talking to liberal arts people about capitalism when we're not actually talking about capitalism. Like, we're talking about the name capitalism, but what we really mean is like rich people. You know, and rich aspiration. We're not talking about machinations. Like, what is the effect? What effect does downward mobility have on a middle class population, one generation that becomes a lower class population in the second and third generation out? Right? What are we talking about in terms of the mental health effects of poverty, witnessing of violence, neighborhood isolation, segregation? Those are the questions that I'm interested in. I want to know what the effects of those things are. And I haven't had generative conversations in the academy thus far in my field, in liberal arts, about those sets of questions. So capitalism is there, but I'm more interested in the effects that capitalism has at a much more material and concrete level on Black people, specifically Black men and boys.
So listen, we're coming up on the end of the second hour here. Obviously there's, and there's so much more to get to. I will defer to you, Kwasi, for any last questions. And then I'll say again, certainly here at BPM, and we're happy to have more of these conversations. And obviously both of you are welcome back. BTAC is going to be coming back at some point anyway, but you're both welcome back to do more of this, parts .. et cetera, and so Absolutely. Forth, as much as you all like. So, but I do at least be a little bit mindful of the time that and all of our schedules, frankly. And anyway, I'll defer to you, Kwasi, and I'll thank everybody now for having come on out and offering their good questions. And obviously, we hope the conversation continues. But please go ahead.
Well, definitely. I guess the last question would be on that theme of capitalism, not for the idea, but you write about Black males as a certain kind of worker. I think the phrase you use as undesirable workers, right? Mm-hmm. Toward, I think, the middle latter part of the book. And there's some new scholarship, recent scholarship, I should say, on the interplay between slavery and capitalism, and that scholarship, whether it's Skimmerhorn or others, this is U.S. capitalism, to be clear. They argue that capitalism didn't need slavery. Basically, it used chattel slavery as a prop, as a tool, mm-hmm. but it doesn't require it. And so, when chattel enslavement morphed into whatever form, Jim Crowism, etc., capitalism will still persist as sort of a creature. I remember in the 1970s, you all may remember too, at least films 1970s, because I was born in 1970s, films about it. It's a film called The Blob. Remember The Blob?
Yeah, I remember.
Right. So this creature, if you think of capitalism as a creature, right, that just kind of, absorbs and sucks in, everything in its path. So their argument is simply that chattel enslavement was simply a prop along the path, right? This blob-like path, and that's part of my interpretation. But they argue that basically a chattel enslavement, wasn't fundamental to capitalism; that it was simply just one of several props that it would use to subsist.
Yeah,
and so within that frame, how do not simply Black males, boys and men, in particular, but Black people in general, think through, or against, this sort of blob-like creature that everyone's expendable.
Yeah, I mean, that's interesting. I mean, I need to read that, but it doesn't really change our circumstance. The question of whether it was a necessary or sufficient condition for capitalism, means it still happened. I think that
it's like, so you say, damn, we had to go through all that for nothing? Is that what you're saying?
That's what I
wasn't heard. Even essential to the joint. come on, man.
but that's what I'm saying, man. Like, there's a kind of, when you look at what's happening to Black people, there's a certain kind of cynicism that rings about the ways that we investigate, our terror and tragedy, because even the question, how do we think ourselves out of capitalism, right? How do we think ourselves out of the disposability that the world's imposed upon us, knowing that any moment us thinking could be our last thought because we're disposable, right? Like, it's a paradoxical question, because the idea is that the world has seen no use for Black people. We reside only in our thoughts for other Black people, basically, and other oppressed people. But all those oppressed people are expendable to white people because they don't care. And I think that it's that pessimism that creates the kind of profound analyses that Black people do create throughout history. Like, we're brilliant people. Like, I don't care what white people have written. Like, and I've read practically most of the canon, right? The Western metaphysical canon. It doesn't compare to what Black people were writing in the same time period. So I think the question of how we think ourselves out of capitalism is basically the same question we asked earlier. Like, can we ever integrate into society? Like, we can't, right? Like, our strategy has been to find a way to survive and undo, right? To the best of our ability. And the reality of the situation is that as long as capitalism is coterminous with white supremacy, because it's the way the empires and post-colonial states work, it's gonna be there. So we can't think ourselves out of it. What's gonna be our solution? Well, to try to stave off disposability. But as you and I both know, that's a dead end process, because we don't get to decide when we die, right? States do, police do, right? I think ultimately, and I'm actually writing a book on this about Derek Bell. I think that we persevere. I think that we find new ways of striving. And, if it comes down to it, I think that, we find different ways to revolt and resist, even if that becomes violent. I just don't think anything is off the table. Because what I've seen is an acceleration of racial phobia and racial categorization, even within the last decade, despite the language saying that these things are supposed to be naturally subsided with the civil rights movement and the passage of certain bills, et cetera. And what makes me, I guess, the saddest is that even when you look at the ways that Black thought is now commodified, there's a neoliberal ethic to that. So even a movement like Black Lives Matter, which was touted by every practical white liberal I know as being the basis of our liberation, is in bed with corporations. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I don't know, Jared, I don't know if we had that conversation a few years ago too, but, you know, I think—
Maybe, I've had it so many times with so many people, I can't—
Yeah, but even when, you know, I used to call him Mr. Blue Jack, it was on Twitter, mm-hmm. you know, posting McDonald's advertisements. I was like, are we really serious? Do we really believe that a revolution is going to be had on Twitter? I just couldn't believe it. So we have both the impossibility of the act of thinking itself, because we're thinking in capitalist terms, the language of rights, property, rebellion, et cetera. These are all capitalist metrics, because our protests being nonviolent is a capitalist assertion. That's not damaging property, not taking human life. These are all neoliberal assertions about the values of human beings versus punishments. These are all wrapped into those logics. But even more so and more concerning, besides the constraint of that kind, those kinds of ideas, we find that we have generations of Black people who actually think social media is a liberatory mechanism. Mm-hmm. They somehow believe that operating, sharing, buying, advertising, and endorsing certain corporatist products and images actually are going to free Black people. So I moved out to the UK. Next thing I know is Tamara Mallory is on TV with Cadillacs. Mm-hmm. You know, like these things are not—
Tamika Mallory, yeah.
Tamika Mallory, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. Tamika Mallory is on TV with Cadillacs. Mm-hmm. Somebody signed a deal with Warner Brothers. You know, I get this kind of secondhand because I don't see it in real time, because I'm in a different country. But, you know, this is nonsense, brother. Like, you know, and this is, and, you know, I'm sure you've seen my rants on Twitter where I was like, well, let me get this straight. We claim that Black men who wanted to be patriarchs but were ultimately exiled or killed created movements that wanted to buy into the system. And here you have the second civil rights movement literally being bought off by Warner Brothers, Cadillac, and all kind of corporate mechanisms. Make it make sense. Mm-hmm. We demonize the brothers who were dead because they were fighting against the state, but we celebrate the Black women who are alive that are in bed and selling contracts and cars for the state.
That's some metaphor in bed.
Well, no, literally in bed. I mean, that's deliberate. Like, I don't understand, because poor Black people are dying. You see, this is what I'm saying. Poor mm-hmm. Black men and women are dying. They may be dying in different ways, but our people are dying. That's the bottom line. No debate, absolute certainty. But then I get people who I'm told that I can't question because they're women, or because of their sexual identity, or because they started a hashtag. And I genuinely want to know, because I come from a group of people that live in Lake Charles, Louisiana, that are not formally educated. I come from groups of people who depend on federal assistance after hurricanes hit their homes. I come from those people. So I want to understand genuinely. I genuinely want to understand what's supposed to be my responsibility and reaction when I see people who say they represent me not care about the people they claim to represent. And see, that those basic kinds of questions are what infuriate me about these kinds of performances. Nobody with any kind of two cents would believe that making a hashtag and nonviolent movement is going to take down a military police state. Nobody thinks that. Over a decade, there's not been any decreases of Black men's death in the United States. There is no empirical evidence that Black Lives Matter has worked except making certain people and certain groups of people richer. But the same poor Black people that are dying are still poor. And the assumptions that somehow as an academic, I'm not supposed to care about, and this is what I write about in chapter 3, I'm not supposed to care about the people that I come from, that there's supposed to be some sort of distance, right? I'm supposed to know the nod and the wink, wink, that I support Black Lives Matter because it's about Black people, but it doesn't help Black people, right? And this is the problem. The problem is that you look at white people, as much as we look and criticize their privilege, white people care about other white people, because white people write stories and scholarship that benefit white people and future generations of white people. But we're supposed to celebrate people who are signing contracts and their lives away. Who's the woman, the woman that bought million-dollar houses that just resigned because she didn't want to turn over the financial records?
Yeah, Patrice Cullors.
Yeah. Like these are our leaders. You see, the problem is the dishonesty, and I mean this very seriously, gentlemen. The problem that I see not only with the academic class of Black people, but also with Black people who are disempowered, is that we hold no standards about what's the basis of our representation. Somebody comes up and becomes a leader because white people recognize that person as a leader for Black people. They become spokespeople because white people recognize those people as spokespeople for Black people. And the minute we step out of line, the minute working class Black men and women, especially young Black men, are identified and speak up for their people, they're killed or they're put in jail. And we accept this. We accept this as progressive. We have academics that celebrate. And at the same time, the same groups of people that we all claim that we get our jobs to speak on their behalf and to study are still becoming worse off. You know, Black male studies is talking to those people. Black male studies is not interested in bourgeois Black men who work in the academy. That's not our subjects of study. We're studying people who are brutalized, abused, who have mental health issues. Right, we're theorizing their experience. We're reaching out and saying that that's our population of interest. Right, and despite the criticism that people may give to various Black male studies scholars, there's no one else in the academy doing that kind of work. There's nobody else talking to Black men who are victims and Black men who are beaten up with mental health issues and actually talking to them and studying them and trying to actually get their experiences of the world as the basis of their scholarship. And that's something different. It's unpopular now. But in 20 or 30 years, the question is going to be what Black scholars or what groups of Black scholars dare to go back into their own communities, the people that are suffering and dying, and try to capture how they saw the world. Right. And we see some value in that. Mm-hmm. Right.
As do we. Deeply appreciate it. Look forward to getting more and keeping it going. Dr. Curry, Dr. Konadu, definitely appreciate you joining us for this discussion and helping us put this together. And want to invite people to stay in touch not only with BPM, but the Blacklash Africana Collective as we look to continue to have more forums and bring back more of the collective to be participating in it. And I just wanted to say again, thank you, Dr. Curry, because I know part of this also emanated from your comradely criticism of our panel on womanhood. And I know that I hope that this offers a nice addition to that conversation as well. So absolutely. I appreciate both absolutely. Of you and everybody in the audience as well. Thank you all very much.
Appreciate it, man.
All right, everybody, take good care. Thanks again to our guests and everybody in the audience. As Fred Hampton used to say to you, we say peace if you're willing to fight for it. So peace, everybody. Thanks again on behalf of Blacklash Africana Collective and BPM. We'll catch you next time. Take care, everybody.
Enjoy it, bro. You're the only power. You're the only power. You're the only power.
If young Metro don't trust you, I'm gonna